You're listening to the Pine Room Podcast, the home of sports, gambling, entertainment, and whatever the hell else has gone on this week. So pull up a seat by the fire, crack open a cold one, and make sure to get your bets in. Welcome to the Pine Room.
All right, hello and welcome back to the Pine Room Podcast, episode 11. We made it past 10 last week. It was a fun episode. We had some technical difficulties getting the video out, so that'll be out probably today, so 2 days ago from when you're listening to this now. So if you haven't seen that, that's up on our YouTube, and you can go find this on YouTube the same day, normally Thursday when this comes out as audio. But yeah, we had a good week last week. Had some had kind of a bit of some time off since the live shows. It was kind of a breather for most of us after we've been through the gauntlet of doing live shows. But other than that, not a whole lot went on as far as my neck of the woods. You guys, though, we put our picks out on Friday of last week. I didn't put any picks out, but if you haven't seen those are on our Instagram every Friday at about 11 o'clock, actually about 10:30, those come out. If you're a betting fan, if you're a gambler, look at our picks. Chris, yes. You were hot on NHL.
I think I went 5-0 in the past couple weeks, but
jeez.
The sad thing is I didn't make one bet on any of the games.
I wish
I was Nick Nardone in that.
That might be the secret, Chris.
But bragging rights really done.
Chris, the way my luck's been going, if I would have bet on those games, you'd be 0-5.
or if I would have bet them, I'd have been 0-5. Right. Hopefully any of the listeners or viewers took my advice and bet them, maybe won a few dollars. But you know how it is, Nick. It's streaky, right?
So what'd you take, Chris? What'd you bet?
I would just do the money line.
Yeah. But, just winners.
Yeah. But no, I would have lost last night's game. I would have definitely bet the Hurricanes, and they got their asses beat.
Well, we have no written record of that.
It's off
the books.
But hopefully nobody tailed me. I was 0-2 again.
What'd you bet? Pirates?
Pirates. Oh, no. I actually had the Yankees Rays over 7.5, and the game ended in 2-0. I had that over, and I had actually another Call of Duty League bet. I had the Boston Breach beating the Los Angeles Thieves. Boston Breach got beat 3-0.
So do you actually know any of the players for those teams, like on the eSport teams?
I know all of them.
You know, like every single player?
Yeah. No, I mean, I wouldn't say every single, because they sub out sometimes, and there's some guys that, like, I don't know. But I follow it pretty heavily. You know, that wasn't a very good pick of mine, but...
Well, I hate to say it. I kind of...
Yeah, what'd you
faded,
do?
I kind of faded your Yankees Rays over and played the first inning under. That hit with flying colors. My Tigers Indians first inning under for plus money. That was postponed Friday night, so I didn't follow. I don't know if they made that game up in a doubleheader or not to where, but that washes it. Once it's postponed and I don't have the nighttime vibes, that bet's voided.
That doesn't count.
The Astros suck. But
on that first one, you were was that sarcasm or were you serious?
Serious. The game was, I believe the game was, I think if you would have bet the first first four innings under, you would have hit zero.
So if you just do the first inning, what is that? You like a run? Run and a half?
It's 0.5. If there's no run, it's basically no run scored. Now, FanDuel offers where you can bet it as a tie with a little worse odds because maybe both teams can score one run in the inning and still tie. But I bet it under. And I believe my picks, I bet the Indians game in a tie, but I bet the Yankees game under 0.5 runs. And the Yankees game hit, I think it was scoreless the first half of the game.
Yeah, I couldn't tell because you were talking about how your luck's been running.
Yeah, right, no, that so, one actually, so, oh, good. That one was all actually right. Good.
Good.
But the NBA playoffs have been detrimental to my mental health.
Well, was it yesterday? You said all the apps are off your phone now?
Gone.
What's the over-under on how long that'll last?
The moment they send me a free bet to get me back is when I'll re-download it. Yeah, it's going to come. Trust me, they'll send
Nick, I wanted to touch on one of your bets. I saw you had the Astros minus 2.5, and they actually ended up getting beat outright.
By 5. it's just bad baseball. They're just...
Who did they play, actually?
The Mariners. 6-1 to the Mariners. The Mariners are
hot.
So-so.
They're getting hot.
They are getting hot, but they're nothing. I don't want to talk about it.
Yeah, PTSD.
Jump, you didn't have any picks, did you?
No, I didn't put anything in. UFC's not till this upcoming week, so I don't know shit about anything else. So
what
I,
is that, UFC 275?
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Teixeira and, what, how do you even say that? Prochaska?
I haven't looked too much into it. It's usually I wait till probably the day before to kind of look into some stuff. But yeah, I don't have much to give anybody right now. But
I will say this, and this is strictly as someone who watches a lot of sports. I think a Rangers Stanley Cup champion futures bet isn't a bad price because I think they're very hot. I think they're playing a Tampa Bay team who knows how to win, but is a lower-seeded team who maybe isn't as good as the Canes. I tell you right now, Tampa Bay's not as good as the Hurricanes are. And the Rangers have made it through a couple tough matchups with the Pens and the Canes, and now they got Tampa Bay. I just think maybe it might be one of those years that a certain team is destined to win the Cup. And I actually saw somebody put a future bet on the Rangers a long time ago to win the Stanley Cup, and it would pay out huge.
Yeah. What's your thoughts on that?
Nick's probably – that wouldn't be a bad bet, but I sure as fuck hope that doesn't happen. That's the last team I wanted to see win the Cup.
You're
a
big Rangers fan, right?
And I tell you, the NHL probably really would like that too. They probably even tell their officials, like, you know, if you see some questionable – you know, a violation on the Rangers. Don't call it. Just
why is that? Because I don't know.
Just New York, the New York market, and the Rangers haven't won the Cup since I think '94.
Chris, let me ask you this: your opinion on NHL. What's your opinion on how far back they can go and review offsides on goal calls? I mean, there's times that they keep the puck in the offensive zone for
four or five minutes.
They score a goal, everybody celebrates, and then they review 5 minutes ago and on the entry pass. They said it was offsides by about half a puck.
I'm actually never watched a game when that's actually happened. When one team, like you said, and they go offsides and then they're, you know, skating around for 5 minutes, just like what Tyler was talking about that
3-pointer
game 7 the other night. Like
Cool, give us your thoughts. This is like a therapy session
for you.
Unfortunately, had to lay your heat to rest.
Yeah.
Give me your thoughts.
I just think it's complete bullshit. That how can you take a 3-pointer, make it, wait 5 minutes later by reviewing it, and then change the result? Because I think that changes the way a team plays depending on how big of a lead they have. You can't just change the score 5 minutes later.
And isn't it funny when you look at the final score, what three more points would have done?
Oh, it would have been huge.
And I'll say this. I'm okay with it. But the standard's got to be the standard. Cooley. I'm on your side. Let me stop.
I didn't say anything.
I saw your face. The standard's got to be the standard. And they were not reviewing that all regular season. They were reviewing that all postseason. But now a Game 7 Eastern Conference Finals happens, and they're going to take away his heel might have been on the line. That has got to be a judgment call. You see it in every NBA game when the guy's heel goes back too far. And they haven't reviewed it all year. Now, maybe if there was a stoppage right after, they review it. But then it's play on. And that was in the second quarter,
I believe. The thing. I was going to say, the game didn't stop. And did they ever even announce that?
Because I was watching with you guys and Spencer, like, they just took 3 points off the board.
I remember that.
So for those of us, sports challenged who don't know much about what happened, explain what happened.
So he took a corner 3-pointer, and they originally reviewed it to see if his foot was on the 3-point line to make it a decision if it was a 3 or a 2, and then they saw that his foot was on, his heel was on the out of bounds line, which after watching the video, I don't really know if it was even out of bounds, but they went back, they were originally viewing if it was 2 or 3, and they decided his foot was out of bounds, so they took 3 points away from the heat later on.
And that was 5 minutes in after?
Yeah, it was like 5 minutes after, so the game was already going on. I think that's got to be a decision you make right away.
Does that ever happen?
I've watched a lot of basketball, and I've never seen it happen so late. Like, I've seen reviews, and then they immediately turn it over. But to wait 5 minutes.
I think that needs to be a final, like the NFL. The booth initiates in the final 2 minutes of the half in the game, reviews like that. In the middle of the second quarter, I do not think that they should be able just to say, let's go look at that, and then yank it off the board.
Like
the,
it's like statute of limitations. Like mm-hmm. After yeah. a certain amount yeah. of time, it shouldn't be able. You right. shouldn't be able to right. you know penalize. Here is my question. So if let's say they were up by two, going in, like in the second quarter, just as an example, they're up by two. After that, like throughout that 5 minutes, they take those three off. Let's say at the end of the game. So at the end of the game, they're up two. They take three off at the end of the game. They can lose.
Well, I don't think it would get to that. Yeah, hypothetically, they could. But if that happened in the second quarter, it would be off before halftime.
There would be murder.
Well, Cooley, I don't really feel so bad for you. Now, I didn't know it was in the second quarter, so quit your crying.
Jesus.
I thought it was like with 5 minutes to go in the game.
No, it's still a huge three-pointer.
Every point counts in a game.
You
got to overcome. You can't just blame it on the refs.
Well, I wasn't completely blaming it on. I'm just saying I just don't agree with how they handled it. I thought they should have made a decision right away.
I think one of the worst jobs in all of sports is to be either a referee and umpire or a referee in football or a referee in the NBA. I think I did
have a question, Chris. Did the Cavs make the conference finals?
No, they lost the play-in tournament. Yeah. But we're coming. Don't worry about it.
Go Cavs.
Bron's not coming back home anytime soon.
We don't want him.
It's not a bad job if you take pride in it.
But I'm saying, like, no matter what you do, it's like when people when you're a treasurer. When you become a treasurer, you're immediately corrupt. So, like, if you're a referee, you're immediately wrong.
Chris, aren't you the Pine Room treasurer?
Yeah.
I don't think Chris is corrupt.
Finances are pretty.
He just said correct.
No, not corrupt. Yeah. Right.
No. When you become a treasury, you become corrupt. Yeah. And you said correct.
And you're the treasurer.
No, I was just in general. Not generalizing. Not Chris Pavlin.
No. Okay. Clear the air. The Pine Room funds are safe.
We're safe. Yeah, we're good to go.
And I forgot to do this last week. And Chris, we talked about this. We got to give a shout out to Danielle and Danielle.
Yes,
one down
D&D.
At the tax building, down at the tax building, down in Wheeling, and down at Main Street Bank. I think this also can lead us into another conversation. But Chris and I were talking about how customer service like changes the way that you. Interact or change the way that you just go about shopping. Like we went into the tax office. Danielle, who took care of us at the tax office,
we had no clue what we were doing.
No idea. I'd never been in there before. We'd never done any of that.
It's
stuff
a scary
before.
Place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she came out. She was real helpful to us. She was very sweet, nice lady. Helped us out with some stuff, and she said, "If you ever need help, just call and ask for me."
Yep.
So
she was
great.
Terrific. Thank you, Danielle.
That's going to lead me into a point.
Well, before you get to that, and Chris and I, before we left. We were like, what's the odds that we're going to get somebody as nice as that lady? Or no, then we go down to Main Street Bank, and there's a lady that we go in. She's sitting probably, I think, a couple years older than us, and she was running the bank. Sweetest girl. I mean, she was so nice. She actually went a step ahead and helped us out with getting
Danielle Martin.
Yeah, Danielle Martin.
Thank you, Danielle. She was, I mean, back-to-back great customer service experiences. It was great. Your dad told me, Mark said he was going to mention something to Rich Lucas about how we were treated down there, how she was so awesome.
It could have gone easier. Like you said, we'd never done any of that, at least the tax stuff. I've never done any
before. Thanks to Danielle down there.
So they weren't corrupt?
No. Thanks to Danielle. No. Danielle squared.
Yeah,
both of them.
Danielle's second power.
But our point was, we were talking about, what are the chances, like, if we would have gone in there and they would have been real mean or real just bitchy, like that we didn't know what we were doing, it would have changed the whole outcome of the day, like, mm-hmm. at least for us, even just the mood of the day. But, like, I think you said you were in paint.
I went down to a Lumber Liquidators, I think, the previous day, and the guy couldn't have been any nicer.
Yeah.
Just I was only there just to get a couple samples, but he was tremendous. And when we were standing there in the tax office waiting for Danielle, we were talking about that. I'm like, man, it's a rarity to get good customer service anymore. So I had that experience in the two that morning.
Because it's not uncommon for you to get in there. There's some dickhead who doesn't want to be there and then takes his anger out on you.
Right. And then, you know, if we ask a silly question, they're put off by it. Like these two dumbasses. They don't want
it. But we had a great day.
We got lucky that day.
Shout out to Danielle and Danielle.
Yes, thank you very much.
It was great. But, Nick, what were you going to say?
Well, I just think that this kind of – and this will get me going, but, but I think nowadays that's taken for granted, what you guys just said.
Customer service?
And I, listen, I love to travel. I love seeing new places. I love spending time in new places. But there's one thing I love, and it's the city of Wheeling. And everybody, and that might not be a good, people will look at me like, oh, look at this guy, he won't leave. No, I leave every summer, multiple times. I've been to Alaska. Yep. I've been all these different places. I love seeing it. But you know what? I also love going to Kroger and the person grabbing something off the shelf for me and asking me how I am when they don't even know me. And I can guarantee you this, at a Publix in Florida, they're not handing me it. They're taking it, and it's the last one, and they're laughing at me.
Nick, that reminds me.
It is a good place, and not everybody. It's called the Friendly City for a week for a reason, and not everybody's nice.
Right.
Nowhere. But it is a good place. It is a, and they, you can say, oh, it's his comfort level, this and that. Yeah. I like being comfortable.
It reminds me, Nick, like, well, with Wheeling, everybody being friendly. Like, when we went to Key West, and we all, us four here went to Key West last summer, and when we went out to eat for the first time, we asked if the checks could be separate, and...
Well, in common practice, like a waitress will come up to you and say, are you together or separate?
Yes, and she had never she didn't ask us that. So at the end when we said, yeah, the checks are going to be separate, you would have thought that we committed murder.
And side note for the listeners, in Key West, a piece of pizza is 15 times more expensive than it is at Vicelli's. So, like... Yeah, one of us, we could have each paid for everybody's meal one time and dropped $500 a check.
There's eight of us. I mean,
a can of beer down there was $7. A can was $7.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we're sitting at the table like we got all of our phones out trying to calculate who's paying this and that.
It was just such an inconvenience.
Yeah, and she could have just said, "Oh, okay, we'll make an exception. Like it's okay.
Give me a little bit of time to figure it out. Yeah, and separate it.
Yeah.
And,
yeah, but it was like." Like he said, it was literally as if we said, hey, we just ran over your dog in the parking lot. Like,
it's unbelievable. And like I said, how many times, Chris, let me ask you this specifically. When you go somewhere publicly, do people say, hey, how are you, when you don't even know them?
Well, you mean around here?
Yeah.
I mean,
walk by him in the grocery store. Hey, how are you? I'm sure you say it too.
Oh, I do all the time. Even like when I was up there today, car shopping. I mean, I don't know. I just always think that you can kill people with kindness. Get what you want when you're courteous and polite, and don't. I don't know, but you're right though. It's taken for granted.
It really is. And it's lost. It's looked. Honestly, it's looked down upon. And one of my favorite things, and this will get me on my rant, is when people just bash the city of Wheeling. Like, it's terrible. Like, I'm really out. Anybody out there who has bashed the city of Wheeling, I want to tell you this. I am really happy you're where you want to be and you're having success. It does not bother me, but it doesn't need you to bash it either. You have good memories here. You do.
I think. Absolutely. Well, I mean, I think it goes for any hometown that anybody's a part of. Either you love it or you grow up to hate it, like in a movie. Like, you want to get out of this town for whatever reason. I mean, maybe we're the small minority here. But there's nothing wrong. Like you said, there's nothing wrong.
And that's what we want. And it's unbelievable when people think they can tell people who stay here that they're wrong, because we're not telling you you're wrong for moving places.
Exactly.
There's nothing wrong with wanting to leave. We're wishing you good luck. There's nothing wrong with wanting to leave, but you get, like, shitting on people for liking the place that they grew up in is like, that just always is something that got under my skin.
I think no matter where you go, you're going to get out of it what you put into it.
That's true.
If you're just going to be miserable, you're going to be miserable.
Yeah.
If you want to have fun, just fun stuff to do.
You're going to find the fun, dude. Yeah, I agree with you. That's like, you know, our college choice. You know, people moved away and went to, you know, West Virginia
good
or other.
Good for you. I'm happy you enjoyed your college
experience. And they're saying to us, oh, you might as well still be in high school. Like,
Westland, man. Okay. I met so many new people at Westland.
Oh,
man,
my gosh.
Incredible.
And you people that go away hang out with the same people that you did in high school. So
I just in a different spot.
Yeah.
Yes.
We
could go on forever.
But remember Uncle Larry, you know, he was worked at West Lib forever. And I remember his blood would boil when people always say, oh, West Liberty, the high school on the hill. He'd get so fucking mad about that. And, I mean, it was... And it's ridiculous for people to say
My diploma is the same as anybody else's.
Exactly.
Yep.
Exactly. And I probably paid less.
Yeah.
Well, for sure. the people that say that are the people that have never been there. Yeah. We could go on forever about it.
But why feel the need to say that?
Yeah, I mean,
that's what blows my mind.
Because, you know, they think that they went's better than where you're at, and for you,
it might have been, and for us. This might have been better. I mean, I can tell the story about me at WVU for 2 days. Listen, it wasn't anybody's fault. It wasn't anybody's choice but mine. Yeah, that I have some things going on with my family that I thought better I'd be here. Yes.
Yeah.
But even if I didn't, I wouldn't have stayed down there. It wasn't for me. I just flew by the seat of my pants, and I was back where I wanted to be. Within 2 days.
And that's just part of growing up and maturing. You figure that stuff out on your own.
And you have to. Yes. People can beat it to you till you sleep.
Yep.
And at the end of the day, I'm a big guy that's like, do what you want to do. I don't care what you do. I don't care what you believe in, what you do, where you go. Just do what you do. Who cares what everybody else
is
doing?
And I hope you're happy.
Exactly.
Whatever you want to do, I hope you're happy. It doesn't necessarily affect me, but I'm not going to bash you for stuff that you think might make you happy. And there's too much of that. And in that aspect, and in the city of Wheeling, and there's just too much of it. Go and enjoy yourself. Nobody is like, oh, well, she left or he left. Nobody's saying that. Just
who cares?
Go, dude. I'm happy
that's
for you.
That's a good point. At the end of the day, who cares? Live your life.
No, in the words of Kager, who gives a fuck?
Exactly.
Who gives a fuck?
Exactly.
That's what it was. But you know, too, and the cost of living here compared to somewhere else.
Oh, my God.
I mean, I'm glad you brought that up, Nick.
But, yeah we could go on about it podcast.
It's not a bash at other people. It's just an overall thing. The entire High Valley gets it. It's not just the city of Wheeling. I can't wait to get out of this valley. I hope you do, and you see new things, and you find your niche.
Well, I mean, that probably, like you said, it goes for probably anywhere. I'm sure there are people that are born in L.A. that say, yeah, this place sucks, I want to get out of here and go to anywhere else. But, yeah, anyway, just do what you want to do. Don't bother
be
people.
Happy.
Be happy.
Be happy. Be kind.
Yeah.
Just mind your business.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah. And don't be a dick. That's the end of the day. All right, we're going to take a break here. We'll be right back. All right, so this past week we put a poll out on, what day was that? We put a poll out on Sunday, but before we get into the results of that poll, right during the break, Cooley had a pretty good question for Chris. Now, I'll just let you ask a question.
Oh, my question was, Chris, when should I just shave my head bald? Like, at what point do I just, you know, take the L and just...
Well, I think I did mine when I was, like, early 30s, so you got probably some time.
I'm 24.
So six years.
But if you keep letting it go, you're going to look like a fool. So, I mean, cut it. Yeah. Or, like, what do you want to do? You don't want to just have it around the sides.
Well, I don't want to look like Manu Ginobili with the little, like, the... Soko on his head.
No.
So like I think I'm just worried about shaving
like
it when
the
I'm like
Ben
25.
Franklin.
Chris,
like,
what did your hair weigh before you cut it? What were you rocking with?
You had a fro, didn't you?
Well, back in the day, yeah. I had a pretty good fro.
Did you use a pick?
No. I mean, it was more of a curly hair, not like a
big bush.
Like a,
on top of your head.
No, like, you know, like, they're back, you know, those big-ass froze. Because I used to love it because Dr. J, Julius Erving, when I was growing up, I was my favorite basketball player, had one of them. But, no, I just had naturally curly hair. And but when I started shaving my head, I had a really fucked up. It was just like a comb over almost, you know, a little bit on the side. And like, man, I really look ridiculous. I better get shaving. Don't just comb it over, Cooley.
I've been doing that my whole life.
You had pretty long hair. You used to have long hair. Not long hair.
Well, when I was in middle school, it was like that Justin Bieber phase.
Well, one of my favorite moments of Cooley's career was he went on a cruise, and he got his hair cut on the boat. Oh. And that pushed him down the hill. That started the spiral.
At a million subscribers on YouTube, we'll put that picture out.
I can go off of that too.
Unbelievable.
That's the day I leave the Powdering Podcast.
Cool. Well, tell us what happened. I mean, what was so devastating?
Well, it wasn't that bad.
Depends who you ask. If you ask me, I thought I looked homeless.
Well, cool, so I can go off of that too. Four years ago, when me, you, and Soup lived in Florida, Cooley and Soup went to go get their hair cut, and of course I didn't get my hair cut because it was stupid long, and Cooley came back, and we had a workout that day, and Cooley comes downstairs and says, "Guys, I'm not going to work out because his haircut was so bad. So you've gone through it with haircuts.
Oh, man. I only trust one lady to cut my hair. That's Amy Amon. Shout out.
Yeah, shout out to Amy Amon for cutting Cooley's hair. I don't trust anybody else.
Which, Cooley, and this is how you know it. He, just to have Amy cut his hair, he schedules the most outrageous haircut times. I mean, it's a Wednesday at 8:30 p.m. Yeah, and he'll say, "I got a haircut at 9.
It's never before 7 no, at all.
Like, what is Why? Going on?
I got to get in, man. I got to get in. And I cancel a lot because I do a lot of BS. And she finds a way to fit me in, thank God.
Yeah, shout out to Amy.
You're like a vampire. You can't get your hair cut in the sunlight.
I'm sure you tip her well, so it's okay.
Yeah.
I'm sure that's why she's like, "Hey, 10 o'clock tonight, 10:30 p.m.
God, I used to have, number one, I used to have a buzz cut, and I never remember when you...
Bring it back.
Yes, please.
I want you and Jared to not have the same hair.
Well, see, my head is too big. I always tell people I look like... You remember the cartoon Caillou? You remember Caillou?
I used to look like
Caillou when I had my hair buzzed.
That's the bald one, right?
The bald one.
Well, I mean, but now you got a beard and you got a mustache.
I look like Caillou because I was totally clean shaven and I had a buzz cut. And then I had the bright idea that I was going to let my top grow out and buzz my sides. And that, I just look like a douchebag.
Yeah, that was a bad one. That was your worst.
Did you do it?
Oh, like, yeah. There's a picture of me and you at a Christmas party.
I think this one's your worst ever.
What, my long hair?
Just because I want you and Jared to have different hair. Not because how it looks. Your hair looks great.
No, my long of the top, short of the sides, I look like a douchebag. And then I look like Caillou when I had a buzz cut. So I'm trying to figure out the happy middle. Because this I just wear it because it makes my head look less big. So
That and he doesn't have to get a haircut every other week.
I literally, when I had a buzz cut, I would get my hair cut every week. Every week I would get my hair cut.
Tight.
Yeah, your dad used to bitch about you, even when it got a little bit long. When you were little, he hated it.
Didn't Coach have real long hair?
Oh, he had hair like
he
this.
He had some horrible hairdos. Yeah, well, just look at those high school pictures. They're embarrassing.
His wasn't like layered like it was mine. Just, it was just one straight.
He had the big swoop.
That was in back then, though.
Yeah, I know, but...
Yeah, him and his short basketball shorts.
Bell bottoms and high heels.
Was it greasy?
No.
Did he have greasy hair?
No, Mark always kept him. He was hygienically responsible.
Yeah.
Well, then he used to rock a mustache, and he used to say he looked like a porn star.
Who?
My dad. Oh, when he had his mustache.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's hitting a dance floor out the Eagle, too, back in the 80s.
he would make me and Jubb get our hair cut. One time we did it... He buzzed us right before we went to the beach one time, and
please say your head burned.
Oh, my head burned. Blistered, and it was really,
like
really bad.
Pus in
my mom was so pissed at him. She's like, "Just let them grow their hair out." Every 2 weeks we were in there with Aunt
child
Kim.
Child abuse.
Yeah, shout out to Aunt Kim for cutting our hair,
absolutely,
too.
Absolutely, and an avid follower. Speaking of dance floors, we put out that poll on Sunday about music. I'm not like a huge music guy. Like, there's not anything that I follow. Like, I don't have a genre that I'm dedicated to. And I know, Nick, you don't listen to a whole lot of music. And
Kiss FM shout out.
but how this started? My dad and I, we were working outside the other day. We actually were listening to the radio, which I don't ever listen to the actual radio. But we were on a station and they were playing the top. I think it was like top 500.
Oh yeah, Memorial Day 500.
Yeah, yeah,
the more.
And Aerosmith came up, and me and my dad both agree on this, that Aerosmith is the most overrated, maybe the worst. I cannot stand Aerosmith.
I disagree.
I think
Steven Tyler just screams. I think he sounds like
Boston Strong version of
Dream On.
Dream On. One of the best.
They are the most overrated band ever. But so that led me to put on our Instagram. To see what people thought their opinions on what the most overrated band slash artist of all time. So if you're not following us on Instagram, you can interact with us and, you know, maybe be featured on the show. So here were some of the I wanted to read some of the responses that we got. We got Brecken says Green Day is the most overrated.
Okay, I could see that a little bit, but I think they're pretty. Good.
Does that mean you disagree? Or
I think they're well rated.
I think for their clientele, they provide good music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I gotta disagree with that one. Sam says Pink Floyd. How do you feel about that one, Chris?
I will tribute that to people that wear all those shirts, like the prism.
Yeah, the dark side of the moon.
And people wear that shirt, like, that probably don't know who Pink Floyd is. And I think that might attribute to that. But I don't remember the last time I've heard a Pink Floyd song. So I don't
know. They're on a lot of classic rock stations. I would not call them overrated by any means. I know their music's definitely different.
Chris, have you been listening to Womp FM?
Yeah, they got a new format, don't they? I mean, yeah, it's more like pop songs from like the 70s, 80s, 90s
way
or whatnot.
Back
yeah.
Then. It's
yeah,
like back, house, back when house party Womp FM and they really play it out. Yeah.
All right, what else you got?
I think one of the interesting ones we got was from Trailer Park.
Trailer Park. This was our boy Trailer Park who was in the
Trailer Park.
Was in the Rough and Rowdy. I really got to disagree with that
one.
He
said J. Cole.
I know you guys don't really
I like J. Cole. Get
Who's
off my
J. Cole?
Dick.
He's a rapper that, yeah.
Get off my dick.
Yeah, G-O-M-D.
J. Cole has a song called G-O-M-D, which stands for.
Well, that's not like his most famous song.
But no, I really got it.
Just say that one.
I like that song.
It's a good song. But I got to really disagree with Trailer Park there. I think J. Cole's got one of the greatest rap albums ever with 2014 Four Still Drives. But yeah, I got to really disagree with Trailer Park on that one. We got another one here from Tino. One Direction, Tino says.
Wrong.
That's not too bad.
I think Counting Stars by One Direction to Kiss FM.
They got some really good.
That's not by One Direction.
Light Up My World like none else?
Yes, I'm wrong.
I think Tino's
One Direction's
right.
got
Tino's
like
right.
Yes.
What makes you beautiful?
Yeah,
that's a great song.
Story of my life.
No, I agree, Tina, they are overrated.
Really good. We got another one here. Luke, not our Luke Doyle. Another Luke says Guns N' Roses.
Oh, I would definitely agree with that.
Yeah, I agree with that.
You like Slash?
Slash. He's the guitarist, right?
Yeah, but Axl Rose, the lead singer, he's just a jackass. I mean,
one song that I cannot stand anymore, and I've heard it a million times, and it probably started because of Step Brothers, a sweet Child of Mine. Mm-hmm. I can't stand that song. I can't.
I'm going to say something that might upset some people. And I get it. I get back then it was new, it was different, it was
hip.
I don't care for one Michael Jackson song.
I don't know about that.
That's a bad take.
Don't care for one.
That's a pretty bad take.
I don't care for one.
Well, and I mean, that's personal. I mean, that does. He didn't say he was underrated.
Yeah.
You just said you don't.
You just
like
you personally don't like it.
I don't see where. I'll say this. I don't see where the hype is.
You don't think he's the king of pop?
No. Not anymore.
I know a lot.
Bold take there.
No. Like, what I'm saying is.
Yeah, I know.
Like, even when someone passes away, they still keep their throne until they're dethroned.
Like,
I think.
All right, do you think Elvis Presley's the king of rock?
I would rather. No. I would
no,
rather.
Not anymore.
Take, I would rather.
He's
take,
overrated.
I think so, too.
Adam Levine over Michael Jackson.
Maroon 5? Like,
yes. I like Maroon 5.
I mean, Maroon 5's got some good songs. Right. Let's go with a couple more here.
I saw one I didn't like.
We got one here. Nirvana or AC/DC?
I don't think AC/DC's overrated at all. I think both those bands are really good.
I think AC/DC is right where they need to be.
Well, I think Thunderstruck might be a little overrated because I've heard it a million times.
That's what happens when your baseball team for 15 years was called the Wheeling Thunder.
And you know the one thing about AC/DC, this was way before your guys' time, but they were a huge band in the 70s, and then their original lead singer drank himself to death or whatever, and that was in, I think, 79, and they came out in 1980 with the Back in Black album, and they sold probably 40 million. So my point is, it's not many times where you lose your lead singer,
and you
become even more successful with a new lead singer.
I had the Back in Black album on CD in the car.
Not one bad song on that.
Not one.
Jub, I don't think you're going to like this one. Taylor Swift from Jewel. Jewel says...
I like Taylor Swift. I like T-Swift. I mean, there are some songs that I don't like of her, but there are some songs that, like...
Taylor's... Listen, this is going to...
She gets down.
Taylor Swift is good.
Yeah. And Nick, I'll agree. Yeah, she writes a lot of her own songs, and she can play a guitar.
There's not many people who can release songs that have already been released as Taylor's version and match the sales. Those songs have already been heard, but it's just her version.
What was that?
Red is one of my favorite Taylor Swift songs.
Love Story? Is that what the
But she started with country, right?
Yeah,
and
then I like the country version.
And she's been really successful with pop music, hasn't she?
Yeah. Hey, you know who else who is into a new genre that I think is going to really do well is Miley Cyrus. She has shifted into the rock, and she has been killing it.
She's raunchy as hell, but she is talented as hell.
She's got a rock voice. That
yes.
deep
yes. yep.
What song did she sing recently? Let me see if
I can
find it.
She almost growls when she sings.
Oh, she sang a song. Oh, it was a cover. I'll have to look it up.
Jolene?
That's a good song.
Hey, just real quick on while we're talking about Miley Cyrus, has anybody ever watched the video about 5 years ago, The Voice judges, Blake Shelton, Miley Cyrus, Adam Levine, and was
singing
it?
Singing Dream On?
And who was Alicia Keys.
Oh, yeah.
They
yeah,
sang good. Dream On. And
that's
it
a hell
was
of a crew.
Yeah, that
because
was
you had so many different...
watch any of those?
It was incredible. No. It was an incredible... incredible video.
I actually had a quick music story. I actually heard this story pretty recently. I was reminded of it by Savion, who hopefully you guys see soon. But he was on a senior week trip for his senior high school, and he can drink a little bit, and he was pretty drunk.
I think a little bit is a bit of an understatement.
He was pretty drunk that night, and he fell asleep. And if you know, he falls asleep with his phone like on in his hand, and he was playing the song "No Problem" by Chance the Rapper on repeat. So this guy, a friend we have, his name Richard Blackwell, was sleeping in the same room as him, and he tried to wake Say up, but Say wouldn't wake up and turn the song off. So Richard was up all night listening to this song on repeat. And this was like a trendy song, so every party they had for season week, they would play it.
So he just wanted to just kill
himself. Losing his mind.
Well, it gets better, because Richard made one purchase for senior week, and it was the Block Rocker speaker. They would play it on his speaker, and it didn't matter. And this is, I wasn't there. We were playing baseball. But the way Say tells the story is Richard would run up to the speaker and just start yelling, "Turn it off! Turn it off!"
No Problem by Chance the Rapper.
I'm trying to think of how that goes.
And a lot of you are probably thinking, "Well, why didn't he just like shake him and wake him up?" Listen.
He's like a grizzly bear.
He is a grizzly bear in hibernation. There's no waking him up. If you do wake him up, the very best you'll get is a sleepwalk. He won't remember any of it. He will snore. I have beat him with pillows across the face hard.
That sounds a little familiar.
So how did it affect him? Did he wake up when you smashed him with the pillow?
I can quote him. and then he rolls over, stops snoring for about 45 seconds.
Yeah, you get that.
And I have that little window.
That little relief.
Yeah.
That relief, like, oh, yeah. Silence. And then it just comes back.
Like, it's unbelievable. Yeah. Matter of fact, next time, we're going on a trip rather soon. When I hear it, I will record it and we will play it on the podcast.
Yeah. You can have a snore off.
Well,
speaking of that, have you heard any on your sleep study?
Well, I'm rocking a CPAP machine.
Oh, yeah. How's that going?
It's hard to get used to, but it's not too bad. I just have a small like band around my head, and it's called a nasal cushion. It just goes right into my just around my nose, and
not good.
I mean, I know it stopped me from snoring. So if you're
at Say Bar,
does well? Say has one, and I told him on this trip we're going on, I wasn't rooming with him if he didn't bring it.
No, you, seriously. I mean,
but does the CPAP itself makes noise?
No, not mine. It's pretty goddamn quiet. Yeah, it's
okay. Well, no, I told him. I said you will sleep.
No, you don't hear like an engine crank
in the sand. You will sleep in the sand.
Mm. Doesn't run on gas.
No. So you should be okay. But
is it comfortable
asking.
To wear? I guess that's a dumb question.
Well, you know what? It's less cumbersome than the last mask that I wore probably back in 2019, pre-COVID. Right. So this was working out, but I'm still not quite used to it. But
I'm sure you'll probably get used to it. Where it's
I'm going to have to.
Yeah.
Sleep apnea is not really, I shouldn't joke about it. it's a serious thing.
Chris, yeah. I wanted to bring back to the music real quick. What was your what's your take on the most overrated band, you think?
Well, I'm not going to say this band's overrated, but I freaking do not like Queen.
Yeah.
I don't like that. I just like Bohemian Rhapsody.
You hear it a million times.
Yeah. But well, I answered your poll question. I put Def Leppard.
Oh, I did see that. Def Leppard.
I don't care about them. So I don't think they're that good.
Who's your you're a big Chicago. You're a big Bruce Springsteen fan, aren't you?
Fuck him.
Chris likes Chicago.
Chicago's good.
Champ.
Well, yeah, Champ.
Well, I'm
Chicago.
More grew up in the in the 70s with classic rock, so I like all the the Eagles and like you said, Chicago, Fleetwood Mac,
Hotel California.
Yes,
that's one of the greatest. Good. And I don't care if it's 5 minutes and 30 seconds long.
Yeah.
I'll listen to the whole thing.
Exactly.
And it is a long song. Yeah. You like Fleetwood?
Yes, I do. But man, all these bands are—they're getting so old or dying off. It's like, well, what's the state of rock and roll now? I mean, it seems like it's all country and rap.
I know. I actually heard on the radio that same station the other day that I think it was the Stones are getting ready for, I think it's their 60th, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I can't believe
and
that.
And Keith Richards is still alive.
I cannot believe that.
They got to end it. Sometime.
Yeah,
got to
be end at 60.
He's
I would
a freaking billionaire.
Mick Jagger was saying, he's like, nobody should be doing what I'm doing at 70 years old or however,
yeah, he's,
however old
he's
he is.
Probably like 70, 78.
That's it.
He still moves around pretty good too. But yeah.
Do you like the Stones?
Love them.
I think Stones are great.
They're probably my all-time favorite.
Yeah, but that I heard that. I was like, I can't believe that they're still touring.
And they'll sell out everywhere.
Hey, you better believe it.
I don't know why I just thought about this, but coming up, because I've been watching some stuff, coming up on, what date is that? I think it's next month. Steve-O from Jackass is coming to Wheeling, coming to the Capitol. So I want to try to go down in there. Have you ever you've watched the old Jackass? Like
the
on TV?
Yeah.
Have you watched any of the movies?
I may have seen the first one, but I just like the shows, whatever.
Yeah.
The movies, it seems like they try too hard to be.
Yeah. Isn't it nuts that those guys just doing something, just being stupid, are now just famous beyond,
I mean, some of those shows, even Steve-O and Pontius, they had Wild Boys, and they would go and do stuff with animals.
But you got to give them credit, because some of the stuff they do, I sure as heck wouldn't do.
No.
Dave Hunter.
I wouldn't do 90% of the stuff that they do.
I'd say 99%.
Some of it's really dangerous.
Yeah.
I always love the when you put a guy in a shopping cart and go as fast as you can, then hit the curb, and then they just go flat.
Well, I always like that. How about the one? And I am going to play spoiler because you should have seen it by now if you haven't. It's been out for months. They put the guy in a room with a bear.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Jackass
on the new one.
Who's in there with you? Who's with the bear?
Danger Aaron. They poured honey all over him. Put him in a room with a bear.
I'm not talking like a big room. I'm talking like a square room with a bear, and the zoo trainer was outside, like, watching him intently, because if he did anything wrong, he was going
to
run in.
Well, they had him strapped to like an electric chair. Like,
yeah, he couldn't move.
And they had a shock collar on him.
That's
funny that I actually watched today on YouTube. I actually watched today. That's funny we're talking about this. Steve-O was talking about some of the stunts that he backed out of. That like he actually like the whole cast like actually is like backed. Like if you can, that's hard to like to believe.
There was
like,
one where they had this huge Olympic slide and they were going to take a bouncy house. Like they were going to have all the cast in a bouncy house and go down this giant ramp. But they said they wouldn't do it because, like, because there was this like 500-pound generator behind them that kept the blow up the bouncy house inflated. So they said they wouldn't do it because if they went off the ramp and landed, that generator would just come and land on top of all of them. But yeah, you think like just something like an idea of them just doing crazy stuff, and now they're probably all millionaires. But yeah,
you think we can maybe get Steve-O on the podcast?
I genuinely, if we reached out to the right people, I genuinely think there would be a chance because he goes on any podcast, and he's such a good dude. He's a great dude.
Yeah, but, so maybe they'll see
maybe
Steve-O.
He'll do a stunt for us.
Yeah,
maybe we can get Steve-O. We can go down. Maybe we can go down the hill in a shopping cart.
All right, Chris. We had NASCAR this past week at Charlotte. Anything there? Did you watch any of that?
I know your dad was upset.
I watched most all of it, but by the time it got to the end, it was blurry. If you know what I mean.
I
remember there was a lot of wrecks. There was a lot of lead changes, and I had first place one. With a lap to go, and there was a big crash, and then you end up winning $75.
Winning a board that I didn't even know I was on.
Right.
Yeah. We'll split that.
But it was good. But I just hear people talk about that particular race. It was sold out and good for NASCAR, but too goddamn long. It was 600-mile race, 400 laps, but it was entertaining. Jeez, it was entertaining.
I just can't get into NASCAR, man. Yeah. I'm just so... Like, unless there's a crash, I'm just sitting there, feel like I'm watching paint dry.
You got to kind of understand that.
I was the same way at first.
If you find a racer that, I like Chase Elliott, and that's partly because of Nolte.
But they never win. If they win, it's like winning the Super Bowl.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's kind of like some of the bigger races, like Talladega's fun, Daytona's fun.
Bristol's
fun. I'm not like, we talked about the Bristol dirt track. Or is that Bristol?
Yeah,
Bristol dirt track.
Gimpy.
Like, yeah.
I don't need to do that.
I'll say this. And I hope I never I won't get into NASCAR. Like, I won't bet it. I don't watch it. Mm-hmm. We were watching Game 7 of the NBA Eastern Conference Finals the other day, and all I kept hearing was Coach yelling about Ross Chastain.
Yes. He told us that night before he came up here. He said he needs Ross Chastain.
I mean, every Chastain, Hamlin, Chastain. Ross Chastain blew it, too. I think he was in the hunt, and then he just tore Coach's heart out right at the end.
He'd go, hey, Sam, where's Hamlin? And Sam would give him a report, and then Sam would go, oh, hey, this guy and this guy, then just wrecked out. And he'd go, who? Who wrecked out?
Yeah. It's unbelievable.
Sam would tell him, he'd go, ah, shit. But, yeah, let's see. What else we got here?
You want to talk about the
No, what if you're about to say what I think you're to say? No, we're going to skip over it.
No. I wanted to talk about what you thought what do you think goes on at the subway crimes in New York City are soaring with 97 or 98 felonies since April in New York City on the subway. What is going on? Take a cab, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah.
I saw
nothing safe in New York, is it?
No, God. You ever been to New York, Chris?
No, and I never. I don't have any desire to go.
Yeah, we were there. We went there once in the city, and I thought I would like it, and it's too much. Mm-hmm. It's too much.
It's stressful.
Cooley and I popped into the Bronx, saw Derek Jeter play in his last season, and popped out. We never went.
That was
deep
it.
Have
New
you guys
York.
Ever walked the city?
Nah.
Yeah, I hop.
I have not.
It's nuts. You see people doing all kinds of crazy stuff.
Nick, were you up there just solely for a baseball game?
We went up to see Jeter's last season, and Tyler. We went up there.
You got a ball from Jeter, didn't you?
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
Someone tried to pay you for it. I can
talk about that story. So Derek Jeter's last season, it wasn't his last home game, but I'll be honest, it was in the second half of the season, and there wasn't many left. It was against the Fins? Were they playing the Marlins?
Yeah, I have no memory.
I can't remember who they were playing, but Derek Jeter was warming up with was it Martin Prado, Jarrett? A while ago, he played for the Fish, and then he came to the Yankees. Martin Prado, second baseman.
I was gonna say, well, I know he played for the Marlins. I don't know if he ever played for
the
Yankees.
I know he did. So that was the name.
Oh, maybe,
he did.
Yeah.
So he's warming up in front of the Yankees dugout. And my good friend Tyler Cooley here, he got us nice tickets. I mean, we were six rows up behind the Yankees.
They weren't nosebleeds.
In the Yankee Stadium. And Jeter's warming up with Martin Prado. And I had the aisle seat, so I was right next to the stairs. And after he gets done warming up, he turns and he's going to throw the ball into the stands, and he throws it up. Now
you lay out,
and I don't even lay out, and it was honestly one of my more impressive catches of my life. Left hand, and I can't do anything with my left hand. Mm. Left hand, I just reached out and grabbed it. And so this guy comes running down the stairs, and says he was throwing that to my daughter. I politely said I don't really care, and he offered me a check for $1,200.
Yeah, something is up
he
there.
Offered you $1,200.
I said no.
Did you get it? What? I'm not sure. That check would have bounced then. That check would have bounced.
But he was adamant that I stole the ball from his daughter. They came from England to see Jeter play. He was throwing that to her, and I politely said, "I don't care."
Mm-hmm.
We're in New York, and it's one man.
Nick's defense, and I never defend Nick ever. But we weren't like old. We were like what, 12 years old, 11 years old. So it wasn't like we weren't kids too.
Okay.
It wasn't
like we
like now.
I'd say 14 or 15. Yeah. But I would have told him the same thing now. If I was 25, I would have said sorry now. Right, so I could. Well. So you could think about it that way, because it's the exact same conversation that would have been had whether if I was 40, 25. 12, I would have said, nope, my ball, bye-bye.
All right, which city did you like less, Seattle or New York? Both of you.
Oh, jeez. Wow. Jesus, man. That's a tough one.
From New York. A story that hasn't been
New
told.
York.
And it'll and be eventually be told
and
sometime.
No, it's not getting told.
It'll be told sometime.
No, we're going to get into it
one day.
It'll be told in bits and pieces.
Yeah, it will be.
I would have to go to Seattle just simply off the story and I don't know. New York just has some excitement to it that you can't explain. You walk down the street, you see just crazy stuff everywhere. And that's the kind of chaos that I love. You could see a guy riding by on a unicycle, a clown across the street, someone dressed as Joker.
I would say New York was a little more like fun and lively.
It's
like
the excitement.
Well, I'm telling you right now, if I saw somebody dressed as Joker in New York City, I am running. I'm getting in my car, however far away it's parked, because you can't drive your own car in New York. I'm running. Joker, Heath Ledger, rest in peace, should not be walking around Times Square. It shouldn't happen.
Got to make money somehow. But, Jubb, what do you think? What did you New York or Seattle?
I don't like either of them, but I
shocker.
Outside of the poverty.
Wait a second. Hold on now. I like places, but I used to think that I would like the city, but there's too much. It's too much. It's too much noise and movement and traffic and like to get food. Like I got a kebab from a stand in New York, like a chicken kebab, and you might as well just put a rat on the end.
Ew.
Of it. It was like gray meat, stringy.
What
like
about that Subway in Seattle we got? It didn't even have white bread.
I'm gonna tell you.
Oh yeah.
That
Jared almost shit himself in that Subway.
Listen, I would say Seattle over New York. And I really didn't mind the layout of Seattle. I really didn't, outside of the one thing we were just discussing. And then it was really, really bad poverty. I didn't see that coming. I mean, there were everywhere. Yeah. And I know every big city has that, but it was like...
Seattle was really dirty.
Everywhere.
It was really, really... I mean,
the
Ferris wheel, that was cool.
That was cool.
The market was cool.
I don't care for the gum wall. I think that's disgusting.
Yeah.
You ever seen that, Chris?
What?
In Seattle, there's a thing called the gum wall, and like people go up to this wall. It's like as big as this.
It's disgusting.
It's like an alleyway.
It's 100 yards, and they put their gum on it.
Yeah,
and there's just, it literally looks like a million people put gum up, which probably is a million pieces
of
gum.
And it's advertised as like a tourist attraction.
But people get pictures with it. Like what?
It's disgusting.
Yeah, I mean, and it was like under this like bridge, and it was like this dark, like disgusting brick, like walkway. Everything about Seattle
guy suckered me out of $20.
But what you get is mixtape.
No, he came up to me. Those are two stories. So one story, we were outside of a store, and I was out there by myself, and a guy came up to me, and he starts talking to me, and. For whatever reason, I pulled out my wallet and I was like, you know what? this time I'm just going to be a good Samaritan and give this guy some money. For whatever reason, I gave him a 20, which I should have never given him a 20, but I gave him a 20.
Well, he wasn't selling you anything, was he?
No, he, no. No, he was just obviously a homeless dude.
Could have gave me
that 20. He was obviously a homeless dude, and like he was actually really nice to me. Now, he probably is nice to everybody to get money, but still, he gave me, or I gave him $20.
I shook his hand. He's probably making more money than all of us.
No, I know. Yeah. He probably is. But
you
speaking
shook his
of that,
hand?
There's. Yeah, oh, yeah. My hand still it still stings. No, but.
You say it like it was a business deal.
Well, no, yeah, I didn't. Right. No, but he came up to me and he was real nice and he was talking to me and he was asking me my name and he was actually pretty nice. And so I was like, okay, I'm going to be a good. Because I always say no. Oh, speaking of that, when we were at River City, when I got out of the car, when I left, I went to the car and a homeless guy was sitting and he asked me for a newspaper and I pretended I was Russian and I said, I know speak English.
You did not do
I
that.
Swear.
That's crazy.
I
Thank
swear
you.
To God.
That's really,
I said, I
you don't even look Russian.
I said, I know speak English.
He kind of does a little bit.
I know speak English. And then he was like, but anyway.
You said it in English though.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I said, no speak English.
Jesus. Man.
Yeah, so I saw that side story. Anyway, so then we were at we were going to get dinner.
We were in Seattle.
And we were going to get dinner by the pier and we were going to get seafood. But what did he do? He gave me something.
He gave me that Buddha. I thought you got a bracelet or something.
They're not these. I got these from New York, but they're similar to these. And he was giving me bracelets and he came up to me. No, that was in New York. He came up to me. And if you're watching this, he came up to me and he just went like this and put the bracelet on my hand. And I was like, oh, all right. I thought it was free. So I started walking away and he goes, no. You pay. And I was like, I'm not paying for this. He was like, $5. And I was like, I'm not paying for that. So Rodney ended up paying the guy. But he's like, that's how those people make money, which is insane. And then speaking of that, my dad said he's talked to a lady that panhandles down by Perkins. Hmm. She said she made $180 in a day. That's a work day, that's what?
That's more than I make.
That's more than a substitute teacher.
Yeah, right. So you're making $180 a day.
It's a standard.
To stand there
anything
and do
will help. God bless.
That's all it always says. Anything will help.
Anything is a
blessing. Do you guys remember how messed up this felt? How about the time we were in Haiti? And we were jet skiing, and we all thought Jubb was bailing, but he ended up coming. But that's a side note. We got all the way out there in this black Haiti's black water is black like as the night. It's scary. It is, and we're all the way out there, and they stop us, and all these vendors come paddling out from
the
cliff.
I mean, they were like coming down like the cliff.
They're like, mobile. Like you, they pull into this. We pull into this cove, and there are these mobile vendors that have these canoes, and in the canoes they have like.
Like
all these trinkets, like bracelets and little knickknacks and stuff, and they paddle up to your jet ski, and they try to get you to buy stuff.
So the thing is, though, they paddle up to our jet ski. We're on a jet ski. We don't have any money.
I don't have
you got all your money with you?
Well, no. So actually, I think the way it worked was they give you your trinket. They give you your trinket, and then they give you like a ticket, like a little ticket. And then by the time you get back to the dock where we pulled the jet skis out, they had already gotten back there, so they wait for you. So you can't steal anything. But like, you're out there, and these guys are right. They come right up to your jet ski and just sit next to your jet ski and like show you all this stuff in your jet ski, and then that's
it. It was a little unnerving. It was like remind me of like King Kong or something. Like that big ass like the mountain
the thing
that
is,
came down.
Yeah, I don't think anybody bought anything, so they paddle out and then spin
I didn't
back
buy
around.
Spencer bought
yeah,
some.
Spencer did. Yeah, yeah. But well, anyway, yeah. So
we
as usual, we got to end the show here with our most notorious segments. That is This Week in History and Hot Pit Cold Mug, brought to you this week by Vicelli's Pizza. We just had their pizza up here. You won't see it on this podcast, but if you follow us on YouTube, follow us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all the platforms, you will see a video dedicated solely to food. It's a food review. We got thin crust pepperoni pizza. We got a mac and cheese pizza. We got their Vicelli rolls. We got some cannolis. The whole spread. As Nick said, we got it exotic. So if you want to go and watch that stuff, go follow us on YouTube, and you'll see that there. And you might see it in some little clips on social media. But anyway, to this week in history, I'm going to start us off, because I don't start us off often. But I'm going to say, here on June 2nd, 1835, P.T. Barnum Circus begins their first tour in the USA. There's a lot of things I haven't done in my life, and one of those is gone to the circus. Have you ever been to the circus?
Years ago, when I was a little kid, it was fun.
There's Barnum and Bailey's, and then there's one out.
Ringling Brothers.
Have you ever been to the circus schools?
Yeah, I thought they were boring.
You've been to a circus?
Yeah, when I was little, I went with Boss.
Was there like a big elephant?
You like clowns?
Yeah. No, I mean, they don't scare me. I just think they're dumb.
Because they are.
Yeah. And like mimes, I think mimes are stupid too. Yeah.
Mimes are kind of cool. Mimes are cool. Yeah, yeah. out of the box.
What do the elephants stand on? Peanuts?
No, peanuts. They eat peanuts.
They stand on a stool.
And then a ball. They roll like on a ball.
Who goes through the ring of fire?
That's the lion.
No. What are they called?
Guys, you're talking about Madagascar.
We're off to a great start here.
You're working on... I mean, you're just basing it off Madagascar, too.
No.
What are the
Trapeze artists.
There you go.
They flip and fly and...
What's that?
All kind of, the trapeze artists where they swing and jump.
Them bastards that flip in the air.
Yeah.
Yeah, and sometimes it doesn't work out. And they hit the ground.
They smash.
Oh, my God. Circus is over.
I didn't see that.
Thanks for coming.
Wrap it up. All right, who wants to hit us with the next one this week in history?
Oh, I'll go.
All right, Chris.
June 4th, 1990, Dr. Jack Kevorkian assists an Oregon woman to commit suicide, sparking national debate over the right to die. And I totally agree with the good doctor, Jack Kevorkian. I thought that was, and I say this speaking personally, when my dad was real sick, and, you know, you hate him, Nick, you know what I'm talking about. When people were sick, and I remember relatives and coming to the hospital and, like, you know, you just see a loved one just getting worse and worse and they're suffering. You think, we would ask, like, we need Dr. Jack here. I mean, I didn't think what he was doing. I forget how he did. It was some type of... I assume shot, but they crucified that guy. Yeah. I mean, I thought there was a need for a guy like that, just because put people out of their misery. And, you know, as a loved one, you go visit and you see him just miserable and you just want to end.
Yeah.
So I good for Dr. Jack.
Well, I'll tell you,
if I'm ever
at that state, you're free to be Jack of Working.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah, we'll figure it out. I think in our third episode, was it Matt that called you Kevorkian because you were the dogs?
Oh yeah,
with Megan's dogs.
Yeah.
I never really did any of those dogs, but anyway.
Chris didn't actually murder the dogs.
No, I did not.
There'll be a new trial coming
right.
out. But
how many dogs is she up to now, by the way?
Huh?
How many dogs is she up to, by the way?
Who?
Megan.
I think 26 or 27.
Well, she listens to this, so she'll clarify.
She'll send us some info.
Megan, let us know how many dogs you're up to right now.
That's a lot of dogs.
What was the one that she had? It was the little furry one that she had in a bag that she had it down behind the bar. It was the little furry one she had in a bag.
Yeah. Was it dead?
No.
It didn't have a human name. Are you sure it wasn't a baby?
Adam.
No.
Adam was the one that you held. Yeah.
No, this one was, it was furry and I held it and it was...
Chad? No, I don't remember. I don't remember. And she's got too many dogs.
No, it was a cute little dog. I held it. I think it was a him. I held him. Anyway, cool. Go ahead.
May 31st, 1889, over 2,300 people killed in Johnstown, PA flood when heavy rains collapsed. I can't pronounce that.
Conemaugh Dam, is that what it is?
Conemaugh Dam.
Conemaugh Dam.
2,300 people.
I hope one day I get to read something positive from this.
I kind of shoehorned him into the dark role. Yeah, he reads all the dark stuff. But I was watching, actually Googled something kind of relative to that. I looked up what would happen if the Hoover Dam collapsed. Mm-hmm. And it was like some ridiculous amount of area would be covered completely by water. I think that it was the Missouri River. I think what the Hoover Dam holds back is enough is equal to the amount of water that flows annually from the Missouri River. So like that, all that wall holds up. The Missouri River could flow in behind that.
They must have a lot of security there because, I mean, what if someone just wanted to blow it up?
Exactly. Exactly.
I mean, people are crazy, man.
What'd they do before the dam was there?
Hey, what was
How do you even start with that?
What was the movie, Evan Almighty, when that dam blows up and he has to get all the animals on the ark?
How about the one in Madagascar again when the old lady was coming and they took out the dam?
Oh, that's a great part.
I don't know what you're talking about.
They got the safari was, everything was dry.
Yeah,
they had got to go. Honking
they ass. Had no water at the safari. The whole pride.
And they blew the dam up.
So the old lady was chasing at them. And they,
is that the one that had a shotgun?
Yeah, and they crushed her with the crushed her into the dam like a wrecking ball.
I don't remember this.
I don't remember it at all.
You guys gotta watch.
All right, Jarrett, go ahead, wrap us up. We got two more.
Yeah, we got two more. But on May 30th, 1431, Joan of Arc was burned at the stake in France.
We got a dark. We're really hitting it with the dark stuff.
She,
this week.
Joan of Arc, she was, by the way, she was a French heroine and saint who was labeled a heretic, a fraud, a sorceress, and a cross-dresser. That's why she was
burned.
That's why she was burned.
She had it coming.
I guess she did. I guess so.
I guess. She
must have been a horrible person.
Any of you sorceresses out there, watch yourselves. I don't know. Well, I used to get Joan of Arc confused with the witch trials. The people that were burned. I thought they used to think she was a witch.
I don't know. Joan of Arc just, I guess, was a bitch.
And kidney beans. Joan of Arc kidney beans.
I don't think she was a bitch. I think people look up to Joan of Arc. But
I mean, not from what this why would
they How get, do you know? This well, is 1431.
Well, I don't personally know, but
he
I know.
He was there.
Yeah, you said, I don't think she was a bitch.
No, I don't think she was. Well, why would they name kidney beans after her? You don't hear, like, Hitler Jam, Hitler Great Jam.
Yeah. And then the English claim any offenses against her.
I'm going to do a homework assignment. I'm going to find out where Joan of Arc kidney beans, where that name came from. I don't think it was because of her, right?
Well, you know,
they got to be. Well, who else would be Joan of Arc?
Chris, that homework assignment's due on Friday.
I'll come with you. We'll figure out if the kidney beans came from her and if she was a bitch or not.
Okay, yeah, we'll have that for you. We'll follow up.
One of those is true. All right. Nick, round us off. And this actually, I'm gonna piggyback off this. Go ahead.
June 1st, 1925, Lou Gehrig pinch hits for the first time after playing 2,130 games. That is the first time he pinch hit during the 2,131st.
And that was like the first. I think in the second episode we talked about hot pick cold mugs, and we were talking about how. It might have been a hot pick, cold mug. We were talking about how that will never happen again. As far as a player playing that many games in a row, like that'll never.
Cal Ripken's record. He was the one who broke it. It is the most unbreakable record in all of sports. Not close. I will stand by that forever.
Nobody. What would you say?
I think that Joe DiMaggio 56 game hitting streak. I don't think that'll ever be broken, but.
Well, let me say this. Lou Gehrig would not last 5 years in today's MLB.
Why 5 years?
But anyway.
5 years? No, all right. Do you think a player now will ever break Cal Ripken's record,
no.
Nick?
They won't let him break it.
Right.
No, they're getting rest days.
Right. It will never.
Science is different. They're all got these body health staff.
Everybody's got to figure it out.
They're getting rest.
Well, then they have to protect. See, now these guys are like assets. They pay so much money. So we can't have an $80 million guy, on the DL. So
all right,
it's just stupid.
Yeah, to wrap us up with hot pick cold mug, we got a guest calling in.
Oh.
Hello, Joe.
Hi, Matt.
Hey, Matt.
Hi, Matt.
How you doing, guys?
Welcome back to the show. You're in Ocean City right now.
Yes, sir, I am.
What was the first flavor crush you... Hello, Matt, first off.
Yeah, my goodness.
What was the first flavored crush you had when you got there?
I had lemon lime and I had an orange. And I've had a few of each.
I was lemon lime.
But I would expect my intake to increase even more if I have visitors on the weekend. <Yeah.
laughs> which I think we might see it. We might see here in the next couple of days. But anyway, we're here. We're wrapping up the show with Hot Pit Cold Mug, and I'm going to let you start us off.
Oh, okay. Greetings to everybody. Who's all there? Chris, Cools,
myself, Jarrett, and Nick.
Jarrett and you.
Yeah, yep. We're down a man today. Yep. But our depth is showing.
Okay. Well, and say chick.
Say backed out.
We lose him.
Oh, well, is Cooley there, or is he still warm in the heat?
Oh, I'm here, Matt, and my heart is absolutely broken.
Both. He's doing both.
Oh, I'm sorry about your loss, man.
Thanks, Matt.
Sorry about your loss. Yeah. Oh, hope everybody's doing good. Hope Chris's new car is good.
Yep.
Everybody should be.
Thank you.
In good spirits.
Yeah, but, we've had a good episode so far.
All right, good. But I'm looking forward to listening to it when it comes out. So anyway, Hot Pit Cold Mug. So as I'm sitting out here on the porch watching the Orioles get their ass kicked, and I was just thinking when Jubb asked me about it. Oh, there's so many things that I could say or talk about, but I guess what really has frustrated me this week is the celebrities and athletes all speaking up about the Texas shooting, and it just gets old to me. I don't ever hear any of them talking about gun issues until there's a tragedy, and obviously that was awful what happened. But Gabe Kapler not standing for the national anthem is just, it's outrageous to me, and I don't think he realizes that he's lucky to live in a country where he's able to do that without being shot, because in other nations, you do things like that, you could be killed. So I think he's kind of not thinking things through very well. It disappoints me that so many celebrities and athletes do this when there's a tragedy, but they never really do anything to help prevent these tragedies. They all talk a big game, but it never really happens. Politicians are guilty. There's blame on both sides. It's really disgusting to me the way that they publicize this stuff and use it to get on TV. Yeah. And every day you got celebrities whining, saying, oh, guns are the worst thing ever, and they're the cause of everything. But every other day you'll hear about people with mental health issues. And while that's a serious thing, and I'm not saying that it's all made up, but I think a lot of people use that as an excuse to behave stupidly. And now all of a sudden mental health's not an issue. Only the guns. So mental health has nothing to do with any of it when there's a gun involved. But every other day of the week, mental health is a serious thing. And we shouldn't make fun of Simone Biles and all these other people who cry and whine about their mental health issues. I just find it completely out of touch. People try to tell us how to live, and it's very disappointing to me. And I know we got a lot of problems in the country, no doubt about it, but it could be a lot worse.
Hey, Matt, do you think any of these celebrities would urge like their hired security to give up their guns?
Absolutely not.
Right, so they're hypocrites.
The thing, there's a double standard.
Right.
There's a double standard in all this. We talk about these poor kids that were slain in Texas, but there's little kids murdered in Chicago every hour. I mean, it's never reported, and it's so frustrating. And to be honest with you guys, you can look around your house right now, and you could find 15 things in your house probably that you could kill somebody with. So, and you can choose. I mean, you're choosing that. Like, yeah, it's not great when we have people getting semi-automatic weapons and they're mentally unhinged. That's definitely not a good combination. And it's definitely something that we need to work on, but don't start blaming the materials. There's a fire poker in my condo right now. I could go kill someone on the street right now.
Ban them.
The fire poker?
Yeah.
Like, are we banning fireplaces now? Like, it's silly. And until we can actually sit down and have an honest discussion about it and hear both sides without each side getting so irate about it, it's just never going to be solved.
Yep.
I mean, Chris, these guys are too young really to remember Columbine, but I mean, this has been going on since the freaking early 2000s, late 90s. I mean, nothing's been done. I mean, it's disheartening, really.
But everybody just gives thoughts and prayers.
You turn on late-night TV and you hear Jimmy Kimmel lecturing you. Like, it's just amazing. What the hell is Jimmy Kimmel about any of our lives? So just shut the fuck up.
That's great.
Anyway, that frustrates me, guys. it has. It's been a build up, and you know, it's definitely a sensitive topic, but
yeah,
it fires me up, and it was good,
and I'm glad you brought it up because we were hesitant to bring it up, but you know, everything you just said was absolutely spot on, and I'm not trying
to say I know what's best or that guns are always the way and shit like that. Like, I'm a pro gun person, but I'm not unsensible to the fact that, you know, there could be different gun laws. They could adjust some stuff. I get it, but it's not as simple as just blaming the weapon. That's the ridiculousness of it. So. All right, who's next?
We got who else is Jarrett's gonna go?
Well, I'll switch this up. We'll go a little cold mug here. We'll change up the mood. That we'll change up the mood here. I got a cold mug for us from the Guinness World Records.
Oh boy!
New record just 10 hours ago. The fastest time to eat 3 Carolina Reaper chilies, 8.72 seconds by Gregory Foster. So for a little info here, the Carolina Reaper pepper has an average of 1.6 million Scoville units on the Scoville scale, and a jalapeno is around 2,500 to 8,000. So our boy Gregory Foster, shout out to Greg. He just ate 3 Carolina Reapers in 8.7 seconds.
Yeah. Whoa, big shout out to Gregory.
Nick, do you think you could do that?
I don't like spicy things.
Jud, do you think you could do it?
Absolutely not. I'd vomit.
See, I think I could do it. I just a matter of fact, if like I don't think I want to do it.
Wonder if there's like a stipulation. If there's a stipulation afterwards, if he had to abstain from milk. Or...
This is what he did after.
God, I'd hate to see what happens when he has to go to the bathroom.
It'll look like a murder scene.
God, hey, Jump, you eat so fast you wouldn't even have taken it.
Yeah. It would have just ruined my insides.
Yeah, I'm sure in the record you probably had to chew, unlike you, Jub.
Yeah. All right, Chris, what do you got?
Well real quick, I just want to give a shout-out to two of our older members of the Vets Club that we found out Sunday that are listeners of the podcast, old Big Charlie Slater and Ronnie Ross.
All right.
Yeah. So we found out about that. I don't know. I was surprised that those guys would even know how to find the podcast. So so Charlie, I guess, needs a 5X shirt.
All right.
From what we've been told.
All right.
He's a big fan.
Yeah.
So
okay.
Just I want to thank those guys. And now that I know that, I can talk to him about it next time I see him down the Vets Club. So thanks, Charlie, and thanks, Ronnie.
Yeah, thanks for listening.
Yes.
Good shit. All right. It's good. It's honestly good to hear, like, people, because I don't know. Do you know them, like fairly personally?
Oh, yeah. I mean, they've been members for, I mean, Ronnie's 85.
And that's that, to me, is cool, that we're reaching that demographic.
Yeah, I mean,
that's cool. That's cool.
Well, and he, I mean, Charlie likes it enough. He asked your dad on Sunday for a shirt. And I didn't even know that because Charlie said, "Hey, Mark, come here. I need to talk to you for a minute." So your dad went down a little bit later. He comes back. He said, "You won't believe this. Charlie, this was a podcast. He wants a T-shirt." But then he said it was a 5X. I don't know where you get those.
Hey, store coming soon.
Yeah.
You can get them on the store.
Yeah, right.
That actually is a good point. We do have a store in the works. We got some stuff coming up. Look forward to that.
The other thing I wanted to say. I wanted to bring this up because I told you. You know, with my car issue, it was a total pain in the ass. But I wanted to give a shout out today to the guy that took care of me up there at South Hills Key. His name was Johnny Percy. And he did a hell of a job because nobody likes to buy cars.
No.
And you feel like you're getting screwed. But I felt like I got a fair deal. Whether I did or not, I don't know. But I when I was driving home, I felt pretty good about it. I don't feel like I got screwed over. So thanks to Johnny Percy up there at South Hills Kia.
Hey, Chris.
Yes.
Let's just hope your steering wheel doesn't fall off or anything next.
Yeah, well, it just, you know, but it's ready to come to the beach, so we're good to
all
go.
Right.
We're just not good. Sure what day yet.
Hey,
Jud, get across the Bay Bridge.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, geez. That'd be a lovely place for the steering wheel to fall off.
Fuck.
Hey, but Matt, real quick, we were talking about early in the podcast, how good customer service can change the whole outcome, and not only your shopping experience, but your day.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
If you have a bad experience early in the day, it can set you off. Yeah. No doubt about it. And yeah. The good experiences are hard to find these days.
Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, we gave a shout out to our two Danielles down at the tax office in Main Street Bank.
I hear they do great work.
My allergies are killing me.
Yeah, how's the pollen up there? Our pollen's pretty rough. We had a pollen alert yesterday.
Not bad.
I won't sneeze over there.
The air's clear here. It's good. I haven't sneezed since I've been here.
Good.
All right, Cools, you got anything?
Yeah, my hot pick is about the guy sitting to my right, their left. It's him pretty much talking trash on the third sister in the new Obi-Wan Kenobi series.
Oh.
Wait. I'm not familiar with the seating chart here. Who is it?
It's me, Matt.
It's Nick. My mortal enemy.
I figured as much.
And it's not, and let me defend myself. It's not me talking trash on her. I'm talking trash on the lines they give her. They don't sound good. The lines don't sound good.
I didn't think, I saw she's taking a lot of backlash at poor actress. I mean, it really hurt.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with her. It's the lines. I think some of the lines are corny, like really corny lines.
I wasn't impressed either. I thought the show was pretty great, except I thought her character was the weakest link of the show.
I agree. I think I agree. I think she's, for anybody that doesn't know, in Obi-Wan Kenobi, Moses Ingram, I think is her name. She's the actress that plays Reva. And
it's not her.
She's an awful character. Horrible character.
Yeah. But hold up. Slow down. It's not...
Not her, the actress.
The character.
The character herself, the way that she is written, is absolutely horrendous.
It wasn't a great job of writing.
Like, I don't think anybody in that role... Really, you could have put... Freaking Fantasia!
I'm just saying, what a bunch of nitpickers, man.
Nick said put Fantasia in that role,
and it would have been. She won American Idol back in
2008.
Matt, I said they're trying too hard to make a character that's not threatening. Like they're trying to. I agree with you guys. I genuinely just don't think the character is a well written character. But like Nick said, it's nothing to do with the actress.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. She doesn't deserve the backlash at all.
She tried to talk tough. I just thought
exactly.
I thought the lines were bad.
Very cheesy.
Silly, Nick, you're right.
Only two episodes in. Let's give
her a
chance.
Yeah, we'll
see tonight.
Yeah, I liked them overall. I was pretty excited. I loved a lot of the old.
And
stuff.
I thought how I'm not going to use any spoilers, but I thought how episode two ended at the end with her just kind of yelling was corny too.
Yeah, she was very corny.
I agree. That scene wasn't very good.
Corny.
Right before that scene, really didn't. I didn't like either. Didn't make too much sense. Yeah. But.
Anyway,
we'll watch for yourself.
Yeah, if you haven't seen Obi-Wan Kenobi, it came out this past week, so go watch. I think the next episode's tonight.
Tonight at 3 a.m.
So 2 days before the day you listen to this, it would have came out. So, Nick, you got anything, hot pick, cold mug?
I do.
Oh, boy.
And this is my second time on the show as a guest of the show. And my first time, I talked about one of my pet peeves, and my second time, I'm going to talk about my second pet peeve. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't care if it's on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat. Stop flipping off the camera.
That's always been a big one.
Take really good pictures with your family and your friends at the beach. Why taint it with the middle finger? It's not a cool pose. It doesn't make you look awesome. It makes you look bad. And it's not a good pose. So stop taking these nice pictures with your significant other or your friends on trips or at gatherings and just throwing up the bird. Because it's not cool. It's not cool.
Well, if you're listening to this and that's something you do.
Who's responsible for this trend, Nick? Who's responsible for this trend? When did this start and who's responsible?
I'm gonna say it. It's my generation.
It's my generation.
Yeah. And I don't get it. I don't get it. I want to ask. I see it so much. I just want to say, why did you feel the need?
We gotta be tough.
To do that.
Well, yeah, they wanted.
This
to make...
is. I want
to
even say, hey, this is a really nice picture, but it's ruined because you felt the need to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's middle finger or some drunk girl sticking her tongue out.
Yeah, that's good.
Like you could have put this in a frame in your living room, but it's ruined. It's ruined.
I don't know. Some people may hang it up still.
Yeah, that's what it is, Chris.
Look at me. Yep, look, we'll be funny.
All right, I guess I'll wrap it up, and my dad's not here to talk shit on me for bringing this up, but it's probably might be the last week that I bring it up, because well, probably won't be. Next week might be, because the verdict should be out by next week. But I want to give a shout out, a cold mug to Judge Penny, the judge who is overseeing the Johnny Depp Amber Heard trial. I just think she's a great lady. She seems like she's got an even a level head on her. Super cool. I've really enjoyed watching the trial. I've watched the whole thing, every minute of it today. They might have came out with a verdict today, and I don't know about it. But, yeah, I've been watching it, and they were giving their closing arguments. And for whatever reason, I genuinely started to tear up at the closing arguments. It just was like – so. It was just like a cool – because it's the first time I ever watched anything like that, and I got invested so hard into this thing. And, yeah, I thought it was great.
I haven't watched it as much as you have, but is it Camille Vasquez?
Camille Vasquez.
She is awesome.
And, she's great.
She's slaughtering that other crew
she's
over
great.
There. But
she's hot, great. Too, isn't she?
Her and – yeah, she is.
She's awesome, man.
Yeah. Camille Vasquez, Benjamin Chu. Great team. And then I got to say this, though, and I genuinely don't – people have really shit on Amber Heard. Like, they've really, you know, drug her under the bus. Now, if what she's done is true, then that's all warranted. But we don't know that yet. So I think that a lot of people were, like really dedicated to Johnny Depp for whatever reason. So they're going to
Pirates of the Caribbean, one of the best movies ever.
So people are going to be biased whether he could have killed seven people and they're still going to want him to be in the next Pirates movie. But anyway, I think it's been a great trial, and I've enjoyed watching the whole thing. But yeah, that's all I got. Anyway, I'm looking forward to coming and seeing you on when are we leaving? Friday, Chris, or Thursday?
We'll find out tomorrow. Right. Depends on work.
We'll find out. Cliffhanger. We'll find out tomorrow. We're going to come and see you.
Fuck out of here.
Get him drunk,
we're
Matt.
We're looking forward to it here. Oh, I will.
Yeah.
We're gonna look, go to Mackey's, look for Jubb's boy TLC.
Yeah.
That's the guy.
Yeah.
TLC.
We're going to try to find Green Girl from last year.
Green Girl, yeah.
Who's making out with girls and guys.
Yeah.
She's perfect.
Yeah.
So. That might have just convinced me to come over.
Yeah. But
yeah, and then we'll go to Secrets where like Jubb's like our celebrity.
Yep.
And then we'll have Curry smoking 30 cigarettes in one
then,
night.
Then fall on in the parking lot.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But anyway,
all the time.
Yeah, anyway, thanks for taking the call, Matt. Thanks for calling in.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me, guys. Sorry I missed. I should be returning next
week. Yeah, but we will we'll see you either Thursday or Friday, and then for those of you that are listening and watching, we will see you next week here, and then you'll see some other stuff throughout the week, and look out for its social media posts and all that kind of stuff. But we'll see you here next week in the Pine Room. Later.
Well, it's that time. The coolers are empty, the food's all gone, and the games are over. But that's all right. There's always next week. Follow us on social media to keep up to date with future shows and send any questions, comments, or topics you'd like us to discuss to contact@thepineroompodcast.com. Until then, we'll see you here next time in the Pine Room.